very closely, along with the issue that he has been pressing for the treatment and prevention, the test and treat, give every person the drugs. If he holds on to this strategy, including what the option B plus that is now subsumed under the test and treat, I'm sure that we will very rapidly get to this HIV-free generation. The second area is the Stop Cervical Cancer in Nigeria. This program is one of partnership. Partnership between the academia, the in-country coordinator is Professor Adewale, and working with ExxonMobil, part of the program is supported by Gates Foundation, and they have been making inroads in preventing cervical cancer. Indeed, in my hospital, before I came, I went to the registry, the cervical cancer registry, to ask them so that I can give the information to you. How many women have you screened in this unit? They went straight to the computer and brought the information out. They have screened 14,500 and something women for cervical cancer. And many of those people, of course, are negative. Those that were positive and to have some, those that were found to have free invasive lesions were then treated. And very few of them actually had true cancer. But it was not difficult to go for excision, and many of those people are excellent survival stories. Now, it's not difficult to, you know, the female anatomy, what we talk of cervical cancer, that is the cervix. And cervical cancer is a sexually transmitted disease. It is not like many other cancer, it is a sexually transmitted disease. And the agent is human papilloma virus, you know. You don't have to be a genius to determine the pre-invasive stages. Because you can, if, even those behind can see the difference between these cells here and these cells here. These are normal cells and these ones are precancerous cells. And you find out that by the time things are taken and we get to the lab for the trained eyes to look at it very closely, you realize that it is important that we get the pre-invasive stages for this cancer that is sexually transmitted and can be essentially cured if found early. But unfortunately, many people, even healthcare workers, and people in an enlightened community like this do not even know how to do pap smears before. And it's part of the thing that Professor Adewale is always using advocacy to drive for. Now, this is, of course, the trainings that went to IIT in 2006 that spread the Operation Stop Cervical Cancer through 6 teaching hospitals outside here, and it included the 7 teaching hospitals. And that drive is covering a lot of grounds across the country. Again, I took a careful look at the publications and used my own type of setup to give him something that I'm sure he will take away. But I want to tell him that looking at this, to go from community engagement to tax shifting, opening things up, using HPV preventative vaccine programs, where we need to look, where we need to look is the population cervical cancer screening program. If we want cervical cancer free generation, we have to take this seriously. And once we take this seriously, then we can get a few cases of cancer very early and go for excision of those cancer, and we will be dealing with the cervical cancer free generation. And this can only survive, it can only work if it's done through partnerships. Now, there is the making side of Professor Adewale. Professor Adewale is one of those who actually started making. Although soon after I started, he became vice chancellor. And many people did not hear much about it in the medical group. These are all people, the medical group. This is in Harvard. And medical brought about a substantial amount of research capacity development. And this was not only among staff, but also among students. And lots of people across the country have experienced capacity development, research capacity development through the learning program, of which Professor Adewale is school principal investigation. Clearly, we are talking about a brilliant student, complete researcher, flawless mentor, astute administrator, and I've heard a lot of these words here already this morning, a leader by excellence, consummate professional, intrinsic unionist of activists, and an ideal partner. Well, I will not just walk away from this place without leaving two words for moving forward. Continue, Professor Adewale, to be transparent in the style that your style of leadership. You know, there's a Yoruba proverb that says, if you are peeling granules for a blind person, you must be whistling at the same time so they don't think you are eating it. Transparency is critical, and it's very important that when you move up to that place, you see all those who have come because of your transparent leadership. People are very observant. If you keep up with transparent leadership, you will find out that you are just a work in progress. Ministerial position is just one of those in the process, if you keep up with that level of transparency. The second thing I want to leave you with has to do with what I saw on Friday in the Catholic Church in the University of Utrecht campus. Behind the pulpit was written, "We are one family in Christ. Our language is love. Our strength is Christ Jesus." So I wrote it down and put it here. What actually caught me is the language. You see, our language is love. And you know, you can't be a member of a family without having a language. Because language is the means of communication in the family setting. Is that not so? So I thought of it and said, there's no way I can eloquently put this message across unless I go into the scriptures. And I want to take you to the book of Romans. You know, chapter 12, it's actually from verse 9, but I will take it from 14 because of time. And it says, bless those who persecute you. Because the verse 9 says, love must be sincere. That's what it starts with, verse 9. And it went on, but I left those areas to take verse 12 to 14. Bless those who persecute you. It says, bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everybody. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it is mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coal on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Ladies and gentlemen, these are the words that I want to really leave with my mentor and very Professor Adewale, and I pray that God will continue to keep you safe and elevate you even further in this new position. Thank you.
How to make a presentation and how to make it here to this week. Thank you very much for that brilliance. It's well appreciated. I want to prepare the audience to say that because of either weakness of my glasses or what I said concerning Mr. Latiche the other time, I skipped my memory to recognize the family members of Professor Ayo Adewale who are here seated, Mr. and Mrs. Akinwumi. Chief. So I want to recognize Chief Dayo Adewale. It is not, the chief there is not a nickname. And it's not an alias, it's because he's actually been so honored by the community in Akinyele local government. For his contribution and service to that community. Thank you. Simply, have you said?
Thank you.
the fact that you use that beautiful rendition to usher in the Vice Chancellor of Federal University of Technology at Ure, Professor Tolulo Okoye Akinwo. You're welcome. Professor Olaya Adewoye, FAS, a man of many parts, a researcher, administrator, and now best listen to a brief presentation about him as a teacher. And to do this is one of our own from Department of ONG Without Money, Dr. Imran O. Mwasimpeyo.
Chairman, the other members of the ITO and then the honorary today. There are so many of my teachers here. And the first I would like to say is that I don't think I'm the most qualified to give this talk. In the process of this presentation, you will see, you will soon find out. I started by having a deep breath when I was summoned by the secretary to the college. Like 2 days when I came back from where I was studying, that I would give a short talk this afternoon. And the first thing that came to my mind was that, from what perspective? And that's how I feel that Professor Isaac Folorunsọ Adewole, acronym IFA, can be likened to an elephant. And you can see that people have been describing different aspects of him. And I will look at it with the lens of a student. The first thing that struck me when I was asked to talk this afternoon was that, looking at student-teacher relationship, and for a short period of 12 months I had outside the country, I look at the paradox of educational system over there between students and teacher, and the student and teacher in our own environment. The first thing correction I had was that when you are to have a meeting with your teacher, both of you must honor that meeting. And that suggests to me that you are on the same level of relationship for that meeting. Whereas, where I'm coming from, some of us have the impression of a master servant relationship. And I want to say, declare there, my little interaction I've had with him, which I will show with evidence, shows the contrary. And this is a challenge to some of my colleagues that we are beginning to start the journey of academia, that wherever we find ourselves, we should make sure that we have a cordial relationship with our students. The second is also the phenomenon of mentor-mentees. When somebody is interested in a young person and is engaging the next comments that you'll be hearing is that, are you in so-so-so camp, or you are in so-so-so camp. So we use this negative, whereas the person has benefited positively. So I decided to look at different meaning of being a mentor. And the mentor is supposed to guide the person, supposed to train the person, supposed to advise. And this advice will not only be limited to academic, the person should also be interested in the family life of that individual. There are several times that you expect a mentor or a mentee to discuss this, and then of course you should be able to add to the promotion. Now there are different work zones that many of us work. There is what is described as a dead work zone, where there is tension and the mentee is often depressed. There is a moral zone. Even when you cover yourself, you enjoy it. And then there is panic zone. When the mentor, you hear that your teacher is on the way, you want to pass through another route. And then the last is that there is stress zone, where you both weather it together. Now this is the mentoring cycle, and I would say that I've benefited from Professor Adewole in all these three phases. Now, these are the three levels. I would say that our relationship has not ended. In fact, it has just started. When I entered the University of Ibadan, I never knew him, I never met him, and I never heard about him. The first time I heard about him was in 1994, as a man that just came into our class when we were doing OBGYN boosting. The first lecture he gave us was gestational thromboblastic disease. And he was, that time there was no PowerPoint projector, but it was slides. But this was somebody that was talking offhand and was throwing figures at us. So we were carried away. We never wrote down anything. And one of my colleagues in the audience here, who graduated, I think, about 3 years after me, especially Dr. Tunde Adeyemi, there was a thing we were just talking, and he said he had similar experience about him, that he's a man of figures. So it's somebody that, and this has inspired us to say that when you want to give a lecture, you must know your audience. How do I know him? I would say by accident, and I also know him through the person that I was working with, Professor Shino Adeyemi. When I was doing my residency and I rotated to the three, that is the first time I had contact with him, and that was the beginning of the relationship. What are my perceptions? The first is that I see him as a corporate person. There was a day I was walking on the corridor, and a very emeritus professor, Akonde, jokingly addressed me, "Why did you dress like a banker?" And what was I wearing? I was wearing a suit. And the first thing that caught our attention as a student was that Professor Adewole would not come to class without being corporately dressed. He is noted for wearing a single color shirt with multiple color ties. And this is what he's wearing today. The second also, which is a confession of about 15 years or almost 20 years, is that I'm sure when he was using his white pens, he doesn't know that when he carries bag, students will be rushing up the staircase to go and collect his bag. I don't know any of the students here who can guess why do students struggle to get Dr. Adewole's bag. The reason is that you will get a thank you of 5 naira new notes. And if I tried to put this on there, because when I was asked to do this lecture, I tried to phone some of my colleagues, and I made sure I got at least 5 of such comments from my colleagues before I put all these facts there. In terms of my exposure Truby, he was the one that facilitated my interest in gynae oncology and the specific thing, especially in the area of screening. My first exposure to colposcopy was through him, and Professor Sange has actually talked about Operation Stop Cervical Cancer, which he led in Nigeria. When the principal investigator came to Nigeria, he's somebody that is also interested in the hospital. They visited the then chief medical director, Professor Ilesanmi, and this is my certificate of attendance of the training that was done in IITA that Professor Sagi alluded to, and this is me trying to struggle for his face to see, and he came in as the provost of College of Medicine that time to see what we were doing, and these are the people from FD Anderson in US. Now, in terms of mentor as for publication, he has assisted me in area of how to come out with good publication in terms of writing books and also developing protocols, national guideline protocols. These are some of the examples. I want us to look at two areas in the spirit of percentage contribution of the University of Zimbabwe. For the mentors, and this is very important. When I started the name, in 2013, I had three publications that I'm very proud of. The first one was in Lancet Oncology, and he said, "Darry, you can do this." And he was the one that provided all the supervision for it. If you look at the publication by Fosin too, there, you also see that it's the last man standing. To show that when you want to mentor, you will not mentor with one hand and collect your own from the second hand. This publication, this idea was developed on Virginia, Nigeria. It was supposed to give a lecture somewhere, and it said, "Help me. I'm asked to talk about human papillomavirus vaccine. I'm sure most of our gynecologists do not know something. Can you come up with something?" And I started having discussion with some of my colleagues. We did a survey, and we got it published. Now, in terms of developing guidelines, I was honored also because he said, "Look, I want you to also lead this process." He allowed me to have the experience of editing a book, and I was part of the editors, or the four editors that I edited, Cancer Plan for African Continent, which he, or when he was the president of IOTIC between 2013 and 2015. His presentation style. Sometimes when he wants to make presentation, he calls some of us and you say, "Look, I'm making this presentation, I like discussion. What do you have?" We will talk to him and you say, "Don't worry, when I want to make my presentation, I'll share the final slide with you." And you discover that sometimes he wants to say 10 things, you are always saying 2. After he has given you an assignment for like 2 weeks, but you come up with another 8 different ones that you will later find that is very useful. The second thing I learned from him is that you must acknowledge people. Oftentimes when people use materials for presentation, this is part of the thing that is expected in the university, and I'm happy that Osai also demonstrated this afternoon. People do not acknowledge. One thing that is characteristic of his own, which I like, is that his acknowledgement comes first after the title slides, which is something that is also very useful. His delivery is excellent. I do not have the right to assess my teacher, but you will easily get carried away when he's giving any lecture. Just giving microphone, it is you that you will say the time is up. These are some of the exposures that I've had through him. As a senior registrar in the Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology when he was head of the department, then I was postmark too. He took us to Abuja to go and develop National Cancer Control Plan, and there we discovered that the process of developing national guideline is quite different from writing the publication. It's another skill entirely. Thank you very much, sir, for this opportunity. Now, other things was that when I finished, he said that, what are you doing? I said, "Sir, I still have like 11 months left in my time." And he said that, "Look, there is this fellowship, you can apply. You only take 2 people, one from Africa, one from Asia. That is Fecal Oncology Fellowship." And I was lucky to be selected to represent Africa towards Fecal Conference in South Africa. And I established a relationship that Professor Adewale stylishly did not allow to terminate because he just told me, Professor Luabi. Because the man that I work with, he says anywhere they meet, he always say, where is Imran? And he discouraged that. He said, look, the reason why I'm supporting you is that you have to be here, not the Stellenbosch. In terms of academic supervision, I quietly enrolled for Masters of Public Health when I finished my residency program, and I was doing it quietly. And during the time that I was supposed to do my dissertation, with all due respect to my teachers who are pediatrician there, my supervisor there, Selina Williams, was interested in me doing something on immunization. And she throws two topics at me, said, Mucus or human papilloma virus vaccine. I decided to stay in the comfort zone and said, look, I will also ensure that I go with two people that will be your local supervisor because it's expensive for them to fly. Unfortunately for me, when he Googled 2 days, the top name that came out was Professor Adewale. So he did not even know I was doing this master's at that time. Then I met him. He said, look, go ahead and I'm ready for you. He supported me and we conducted a survey in Bangalore of awareness of human papillomavirus vaccine, which was a household survey designed using the templates of NTHS, and we surveyed over 1,200 households. But sadly, we got a very terrible result that the awareness was about 4.something%, and less than 1% of people have administered the vaccine for themselves. So it was my local supervisor of this. Now, when I finished, I got married there, and the school said I should go and present it abroad. But I had the challenge of meeting up the deadline. I was to go and present it at the European Public Health Association conference in Brussels. And he said, look, MP, as the funding calls me, I'll pay for your flight ticket. He paid personally for me to fly to Brussels. And these are the two publications so far. And the thought is on land from the dissertation. So when I finished, there was a day we were just discussing on the corridor of his office. He said, look, why I would not want to force anybody? I'm campaigning for people that are a great program. It is a time bomb that we do not know when it will explode. He said, any professor in the academic environment in College of Medicine has escaped. Well, I can only advise you because you are nervous. That time, I was already thinking about Doctor of Medicine. I've tried to enroll, I've spoken with people, and said, look, what you people don't know again is that there is money for sponsorship at the University of Ibadan. I kept quiet, and when I got home, I told my wife that, look, this is an opportunity. The first thing question she asked me is that, how many years? And is it going to be an online program? I told her that I will have to travel for 4 years. And she said that, well, if it's going to be something useful to you, I will endure. Now, I decided to consolidate on the master's. And that's why the title of my study protocol is Epidemiology of and Risk Factor of Orogenital and Human Papillomavirus Infection Among Sexually Active Nigerians, a Mixed Method Study. Research has shown that HPV-related cancer in the mouth, in the genital area of men and women, is on the increase. And in fact, the burden of disease is increasing. And 80% of these problems are in developing countries. Before, we often think that HPV is related to cervical cancer. We now know that oral cancer is HPV-related. We now know that penile cancer is HPV-related and anal cancer. And that's why I want to look at oral sex, anal sex, which exists among heterosexual couples in relation to human papilloma virus. And one other thing that he encouraged me is that, look, I will use that opportunity to also empower other professionals within the university, because we'll be using linear array technique. So this is the project, and it's my co-supervisor on it in Nigeria. Now, in summary, when I was there, I heard that it's coming to North London to come and to either it be conferred an honorary doctor degree. I mean, what I'm going to do for my master is to be there. And this are the evidence, emeritus professor Atode is here. I gladly post with him so that I'll have that as part of my CV, social CV. And of course, other members of, and this is where he was conferred the honorary. It was done at the stadium, Sunderland Football Stadium. It was also an opportunity for me to enter the stadium without tickets. One thing I would say about his administrative style is that he will always say, when you are trying to tell him something that he doesn't agree with, he will say, I love debates, bring your evidence. And one that many of my colleagues that here will remember was one first debate that we had in our morning review when it was head of the department. We were arguing the evidence behind after score at 10 minutes. And it was so hot that it almost degenerated to... So he calmed us down, and the following day, he came in with two files of publications that he shared with us, and we discovered that both parties were correct. So in conclusion, I would say that use these people quotations as our mentors, that a mentor do not train a child to learn by force or harshness, but direct them to it by what amuses their minds, so that she may be better able to discover with accuracy the peculiar bent of genius of each. The mediocre teacher tells, the good teacher explains, the superior teacher demonstrates, the great teacher inspires. On the last note, the best teacher is not the one who knows most, but the one who is most capable of reducing knowledge to that single compound of the obvious and wonderful. I will say thank you for lifting us up.
Very much, thank you. I was saying the other time, there are three ONG. The one that you always obsessed with and ecology, don't want them. The other one is ONG, green oil and gas. And the third one is the ONG of my grandparents. In the world of Monia, once you get to Monia, you said you are going to Sayawero, they know that you are going to be a young guy. And you know the first one, Mururu, that's why. We will not allow Professor Iwoli to take something away from you out of here. You will not remove this song from our mouth, Professor Iwoli. The song that we all had before. Iwoli, Tipas, Kadio, Wario, Sipo, Sipo, and then.
Then I wanted to renovate the Sanu Secretariat
approach many people inside and outside the university for financial assistance. Professor Adeola was one of those who that responded to my request. Today, the secretary is beautiful for everybody. Thank you, sir. When he became the Vice Chancellor of the University on assumption of duty, I approached him on the issue of amnesty for those who acquired a national certificate without permission. The case was on for 110 years. And these people were used in the Department of Criminal Authorities, even though they didn't recognize their certificates. We discussed, he said I should see him probably a week or two after. That I should let him settle down. When I approached him the second time, he said I should go and bring the list of the people affected. I called the Congress of the Union and I asked everybody to register in my office in the secretariat. They did, and I wrote the company letter through the registrar, through the vice chancellor, to the chairman of the council. I was in Akwa Ibom, Uyo, when they called me one night that my chairman, your request has been granted. Today they are using the paper for promotion and upgrading. Thank you, sir. But the other one was not that easy. And that was the issue of bad advances. You remember that we signed an agreement, the campus trade unions signed an agreement with the federal government in 2009. One of the components in the agreement was asset advance. The issue was dragging on at least for more than 2 years. There was a time they set up the committee, implementation committee, headed by Professor Amoye, to prepare the framework for implementation of the allowances. Other unions signed that university should implement according to the interpretation given to them by the agreement. But I didn't sign. This is the first time I will say this one publicly. Do apology. I didn't sign the template. A year after, the vice chancellor was traveling somewhere. He told me, we spent more than 2 hours on phone. He was feeling with me that I should sign the template to let him start implementing the agreement. I said, well, sir, on the agreement, the at least the issue of hazard allowance, which was like one of the components, to be given to everybody, irrespective of your status. He said, but the agreement was what? The agreement didn't say that. I said, well, we have to alter it to accommodate everybody. We were on it. On one Muslim holiday, I went with my secretary and comrade Adini Yako, now the deputy president of SANU. We went around all the principal officers of the university to plead with them that they should please help us talk to the vice chancellor to allow the issue of facade allowance to go around. When I got to all internal members of council, when I got to Professor Adewale's house, I said, Professor Adewale, please help me talk to the vice chancellor. So please pay the answer that I was across for, or else the campus should void. 2 months after, I called the unions to the SANU secretariat. We went and discussed the issue. We were able to bring letter to the management that the vice chancellor should summon the meeting to resolve the issue of underpasses, especially the issue of hazard. By then, the communication was much on campus. Because every security man who see me
Mr. Chairman, General Fansadura. Mr. Chairman, General Fansadura. And these security people are not accommodated in the payment. See, they were asking me that I didn't allow the university to implement the allowance. Well, the vice chancellor summoned him into the council chamber. There he narrated the whole thing that he had wanted to pay this money for the past 2 years. But Omolon didn't allow him to do it. So, if you know anybody will look at me as the problem of the university. At that time, the orientation for the filling of the form, those of teaching staff was handled by Professor Yola, and that of non-teaching staff I handled it. So we said in the orientation from that treasurer that everybody should fill out that allowance. So even if the class is not going to implement it, let it be there. We'll be talking on that later. On that day, on that meeting, I mean that meeting, after the vice chancellor narrated the whole story, they said I should talk. And they said, well, my position has been that this asset allowance and this should be given to everybody on campus, irrespective of your status. And the other unions, I'm sorry to say this one. The NASU said, well, it was part of the agreement, it was, there was no way in agreement that said we should give, all of everybody should give. The NASU said, this thing is not for the category of you. Pay this plenty. Later you consider others. I stood up and said, Mr. Vice Chancellor, if you do anything contrary to your own position, which is to pay it across the board, the campus will boil. We said this in several times. At the end of the day, the vice chancellor said, well, Mr. Nasu, I have you. Mr. Nance, if you have 4 children and you want to give them something, if one is making noise on one thing or the other, send to them before you pay, before you just lose. And Mr. Omolona, as for your position, will pay as an allowance and cost. Today I'm happy, even though it has not been fully implemented. At least we are going to go with 10-50. So I'm sure we'll be incoming a vice chancellor. The old one will send to you. Ladies and gentlemen, I'll say this. And I said something that day. Immediately I knew that you will pay the thing I was bought. I said, Mr. Vice Chancellor, for doing this one from you, by the grace of God, when you finish your thing as Vice Chancellor, you are going to pay the better movement that I will have. Everybody said it to me. Today, you are not a prophet. After that, I think, we have seen many petitions. You see, it is not new. You should allow the petitioner at us to be doing what you want. Humility. PhD is moving down. It was a professor in the religion that said, if it is from the universal river, it is a good policy. And I'm saying the same thing to the President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. If it is ICE voluntary, everybody is going to be there. And sir, I will not tell you what Abraham Lincoln said in his Alpha manner. Abraham Lincoln was invited to the evaluatory election in his Alpha manner. A full hall like this, we are expecting a lengthy lecture. A lawyer, a clear throat. He said, ladies and gentlemen, don't give up. Don't give up. Don't ever give up. Thank you.
Don't give up. Don't give up. Don't give up. Thank you very much, sir. Don't give up. Don't give up. Don't ever give up. Don't give up checking your phone. Don't give up checking your mind. Don't give up. Don't give up. Understand me, I'd like to share this. Enigma that caught me so high today. In my opinion, that is all the way to describe. That covers it. Professor Adewale will also not forgive me if we end this and I do not allow students to say one or two things. The old chairman, Alexander Brown, has 2 minutes to make a presentation on behalf of students of our great Alexander Brown Hall. And we will take another few more from someone and then go to Symphonia before the Deputy Provost College of Medicine.
The honoree of this event, Professor Aye Adewale, the chairman of the delegation, American Professor E. Wakande, the Provost College of Medicine, Professor B. L. Sarako, say that it's a rare privilege to be sharing this microphone with those eminent personalities that have held this mic, and also knowing fully well that the Minister of Health is here to hold this mic. I'll be making a brief presentation on Professor Adewale as the Brown Knight. Well, I will quickly go to say that Professor Adewale, who we are here to honor today, is an alumnus of Alexander Brown Hall, the great Alexander Brown Hall, and alumnus of the University of the Medical Student Association, UMSA, the great supporter of UADS, the Association of Dental Students, the great supporter of APS, Association of Physiotherapy Students, other organizations like FAMSA, AGA, Hamstring Snow, UCH, all are greatly supported by the honorees today, Professor Adewale. I think it deserves a round of applause. Let me say that when we assumed office as executives of the hall, we decided to honor the outgoing Vice Chancellor, Professor Aye Adewale, in Canada guest lecture. But because of many things that happened, the postponement and also the appointments and his busy schedule, I must say that the Professor Aye Adewale program, by his confirmation, will hold in January 2016 by the grace of God. And at that time, we will not be honoring the outgoing Vice Chancellor, we will be honoring the Minister of Health. I think my time is up. I would, only request that the President of the University of America's Business Association, Mr. Temi Osho, President of UADS, Mr. Papa Alamin, and President of APS, join me on this side so that we'll make the presentation together to our amiable father, Professor Aye Adewale. I also appreciate the old master for joining us, Professor Amsas, this side of the hall, so join us in the hall. And the old body who I think is around.
For us in public health, we have 2 things that we benefited from Professor Adewale. He gave us the new building for the department. Department of Infant Nutrition, and another one across the road here to house the Departments of Health Policy and Management and Environmental Health Sciences. And I must say that people call me the official and unpaid MC of College of Medicine. The person who found that out in me is no other person than Professor Isaac Olorunsọ Adeboye. What I see now here, Professor Tanki was coming and we were looking for who to be the MC, and he said, "Who you go and do it?" I just said, "I can't say I know you, go and do it." So if I hold the microphone today, I'm doing so because somebody found that innate potential in me that I didn't know I have. Thank you very much. Also, there's something about Professor Adeboye. I call him my daddy, because he happens to bear the same name with my biological father, because they are born in similar circumstances. So when somebody bears Isaac and Samuel, you know the circumstances in which they are born. He is Isaac Folorunsọ, my biological father is Samuel Folorunsọ. And so that's why I call him my daddy, because he is my, because I belong to their father who has the devil club. So when one father joined the heavenly club, God gave me another father to stand here. Thank you very much, Daddy. And so on behalf of the students and staff of the Faculty of Public Health, we have this token for you, sir.
We will take some prayer again.
Prayer will be singing a song, chronicling the life of people generally, University College Hospital Ghana. The song is titled "Don't Eat at Alabo."
Patient, si, coma, boco, mo, mi, la,
The single ladies and gentlemen, we're really coming to hear our program. From me, I want to say that I'm very happy and I rejoice with the family of Professor Adeyemode that we are in this your honor and your presence. We thank God Almighty for this. We thank God. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, you will see that we only have a presentation of kids. There is no chairman's remarks at the end of the day. Baba has already given us that, so we are moving very fast. There was a program in the University of Uganda some years back. Late Professor Afolabi Tony was the chairman, and then we printed this kind of beautiful program and corrected it. It was the chairman, because they said the chairman's initial remark, and then he said chairman's last remark. And the Baba said, no, I'm not going to be my last remark here. So, just short commercial break. Physiotherapy will be turning 50 in March next year, and Baba is going to play a prominent show there. We'll listen to Baba more and more. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, we are invited the Deputy Provost College of Men's, Professor Adeyemode Adeyeche, to make a presentation on behalf of the following Professor.
The honorary of today, all the distinguished members of the ITU, ladies and gentlemen, before I ask our honorable minister to stand up to receive the gifts, I will have a few remarks to make. The first one is that I have the great privilege and honor to meet with him for the first time almost 3 years ago. At that time, he was a resident of Tor, and I was an undergraduate. And the moment I met him, he at that time was a colleague of my senior brother, Dr. Shek Wajio. He had always caught my attention about his friendship. Even though he was a resident doctor at that time, very much senior, he came down to my level and I related with him. And when I became a lecturer in this university, I continued the relationship with him. I kept on learning from him. And I'll give just two examples. The first was when an opportunity came for a project to manage a UNFPA program for adolescent and young persons. He was the provost at that time. And he tapped on me on the room. I think you should be in charge of this program. He had the privilege to manage the program personally, but he gave that responsibility to me, and I will never forget that opportunity. The second one is that either through my body language or what I've spoken in the past, in his presence, he got an impression maybe I wanted to embrace and re-dream. And he said, he didn't talk to me directly. He called my wife. He said, Grace, tell your husband not to go again. Even if he's going to leave, let him become a professor first. And he kept on providing me with all the support that I needed to publish, to stay focused. And today, I'm very grateful that I'm a full professor in the university. Finally, I want to talk about his diplomacy and political wisdom. He has four of us in his group that he has been mentored in the area of political strategy and wisdom. Four of us, at that time we were all doctors. Dr. Adeyemode, Dr. Alan, Dr. Amzat, and myself. Today we are all professors. We thank you for the political wisdom given to us. We thank you for encouraging us to stay focused. And today we are very grateful. Now, I want to do this. So, Adeyemode, personally in various senses. We have honored him and appreciated him in our various offices personally, but we are not doing this as a complete organization, a college of this. So, on behalf of the provost, management, the College of Medicine, the entire staff and students of the college, I present this award of excellence to you, sir. Professor Isaac Kalonosho Adewale, FAS, DSC, the Honorable Minister of Health, Federal and Public. In acknowledgement of your outstanding contributions to the growth and development of the College of Medicine, in your capacity as the Vice Chancellor, University of Ibadan, 1st of December 2010 and 10th November 2015.
Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I invite my friend, Professor Isaac Adewale.
had my godfather, my political mentor. I think I learned practically everything that I learned from Professor. Chairman, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I must say that I'm short of words, but let me single out someone in this audience who happens to be a classmate of mine, who is there all the way from UK, Dr. Ophelia Wooton. So thank you for keeping your word. I believe that is another testimony to the greatness of the class of 78. And I must say I'm proud to be a member of that set. And we are the only set that managed to produce three programs in this College of Medicine. This event ought to take place on Wednesday. But then with my appointment, I pleaded with the Secretary of College and the Provost that we should shift it to Monday so that we'll be part of it and then have time to go back, hoping that there will be a fair meeting on Wednesday. Let me thank the Provost for putting it together. I did it for my teacher and former vice chancellor without expecting that something of this nature would be put up for me. But then, I saw it as a gift. So thank you, Professor Salah, for the management of the college, for organizing this event, and to thank you most sincerely for the honor. I've listened with rapt attention to all the presentations, and at the point that I said, can I have electronic copies of this presentation? I decided in January to write my memoirs, and I think I'm currently on page 184. I was encouraged by what I read about Roger Macandola and Emeritus Professor Banjo. And at the point in time when I felt like giving up, those books came in strength. And I thought putting my own story in the book form would also be those who would take up that position. The truth of the matter is that if you ask not to aspire to be a vice chancellor, no one will listen. And so there's no point telling anybody not to go there. If anybody told me, if I did it twice, so if anybody told me either in 2005 or 10, I would not have listened. So there's no point telling anybody. But your experiences and how you cope with the challenges will help anybody who is in that office. And then after the appointment of my successor, I said my job in UI was over. And I decided to take a leave. Take a break, and I told Professor Ayinlade, I said, I'm off. You continue to administer UI. I've done my bit about UI. And let me also take you back a bit. When I was appointed vice chancellor, I had a 3-month break. And I visited the secretary of the Nigerian Governor's Forum. The governor's run was still well organized, no political administration of the governor's run, and they functioned well. And I spent a whole day there learning how to develop a program when you are in office. I was taught that my first year should be on consolidation, completing projects that I inherited, spent my year 2, 3, and 4 to complete, and my year 5 to move around and you tend to visit and collect gifts and presents as a member. By the end of my third year, someone sent to me a pair of shoes. And I put on the shoes, they were bigger than my feet, and I put it back. She called and said, oh, how did you find the shoes? I said, perfect. Well, I was struggling and I told my wife, I said, someone gave me a pair of shoes, but I liked and I feel troubled. I said, I'm not calling the person back and tell her the truth.
So I picked my phone and called. I said, I'm sorry, I do not want you to replace the shoes. But I was troubled because I told you a lie. I appreciated the gift, don't want her to replace them. He said, no, the shoes were not actually what I wanted to see. There was a book below, and I wanted to read that book. So I went back to the bank, and behold, the book was there, Finishing Strong by Ferry. So I said, oh, this is why I was troubled, because God wanted me to read this book. And I then told myself, I will not take a break in my family, I will still continue to work. And then I kept on working till almost my last day. For I took my break on October 7th and I went away. The rest is this. I never expected to be a minister. That's the truth. Provost, in fact, supported me to rehabilitate my office. So I must thank the provost. Because I thought I was coming back. But then, I do not believe it is an unmerited favor. If you are a child of God, every favor is merited. But it was an unexpected favor. And there is a difference between merited and unexpected. So to me, being nominated by Mr. President is an unexpected favor or merited. I merit it as a child of God. Me, God, my parents, and my teachers. I've been very fortunate to have good teachers, Professor Ade, Professor Dadi, Professor Lee. All of them were nice teachers. And so, I want to appeal to all our teachers to continue to impart knowledge to the younger ones. When we do, they will appreciate us and they will also lead like us and even better than us. To my colleagues, in the management of you and everything that has been accredited or credited to me was achieved by them. But they allow me to steal the credit. So I thank you for allowing me to steal that credit. You can tell me, I think Wally did this, I think Wally did that, but they did this. So I want to thank you because you did it for allowing me to steal the credit. As we dance what next, I want to pledge to UN College of Medicine and UC that I remain your ambassador. I'm not done with UN UC College of Medicine. Whatever has to be done for you, I will do it. My stress now is the connection I have, which I will also put to you so you. And much more importantly, I will bridge the divide between you and the College of Medicine. When I drove in this morning, I wanted to say, I signed his visitor group and I said, I will support UC to be the foremost teaching hospital in Nigeria. But then, that teaching hospital is called UC because there is a college of medicine. And so, work together to create that symbiosis and to restore the glory. Yes. You say standing alone without College of Medicine cannot stand. Yes. College of Medicine without you say is also incomplete.
Yes.
Both must work together.
Yes.
I've asked the same to say, give me things that we can do to upgrade and upgrade usage. But there is no way we do that without College of Medicine benefits. This is where I stand, and I will stick to that quickly. I think I'm done, and I want to appreciate you for your confidence.
lecturer and secretary to the college to use the inscription by the Sunday MBS of the faculty, that's Dr. Lawa, who described her as Amomiwa in the college. And I said, how can you describe Mrs. C as Amomiwa in the college? I said, you almost are wrong. That if you think it's wrong of me to call her Amomiwa, it's also wrong of you to call her and find her. So I called our sister in the college.
Distinguished members of the active, ladies and gentlemen, my task is very simple. I can see that even we are still patiently waiting, sitting down, and before I give that vote of thanks, I have this word of advice. There was this minister of education who had a PA. And you know, ministers, they usually travel. And it's the responsibility of the PA to pick people who will be on the entourage of the minister. So the first time they traveled, the PA chose one vice chancellor. And when the vice chancellor came back, out of all the members of the entourage that went with the minister, this VC brought back a tie for the PA. And the PA said, Prof, all this for me? He said, yes. Thank you very much. Oh. If you continue like this and you don't change, you will go places. So the second time, the PA ensured that the Vice Chancellor's name was also on that list. And this time, laptop was not too, you know, popular then. So the Prof bought the PA a very nice laptop. And the man said, Prof, all this for you? Surely you will know this. And we heard the story that the vice chancellor actually went places with the honorable minister. So ladies and gentlemen, if you continue like this and you don't change, you won't go places. Days. But I was going to single out the chairman. He had to come in from Okada yesterday because of this program. He's our father, and we appreciate you so much, sir. Thank you for being there always. Thank you, sir. And I want to thank the honorable minister and his beautiful wife for giving us today. It is because of his success. That is why we are here. That is why we are celebrating him. Thank you so much, sir. God bless you. The principal officers for lifting up his hands as his fellow when he was a vice chancellor, we say a big thank you to him. To all management of this stage, all college management, heads of department, professors, staff, and students, especially I want to single out the symphonia. They actually told me that once they do their annual concerts, they don't go out again. And I said, this one. If we continue like this and we don't change, we will go away as well. Thank you all. God bless you.
Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, the only announcement that I have to make, God bless you.